Let's get an expert
here. I'm sure.
Thank you, sir. Can I follow your feet?
No.
I'm now because I'm all going to get up again. So, ladies and gentlemen, Hattie Hayrige is here as well. Nice to meet you again, Mum.
Thank you, darling.
There you go. Right.
Right.
Before we start, just to let you know that you can ask questions as well. So if you want to ask questions, please raise your hand and we will get to you. But we will start straight away. Chris, you are the face of Red Dwarf, would you say?
Well, I'm a quarter of the face of Red Dwarf, really. It's a forehead. But yeah, today. Obviously, you know, given the current series 11 and 12 goes out later this year, yeah, I'm still in it.
Are you surprised you're still in it? Is that something that you're surprised?
Well, no, I'm sort of, part of me is in a sense surprised we're still doing it after 30 years, but I'm not complaining. But yeah, no, not surprised. Once we get out there and get, you know, working the dialogue and get on with the filming, no, it seems as fresh doing it today, these days, as it did, you know, as I say, back in the late 80s.
And as much fun?
Definitely as much fun, yeah. Working with the posse is a good laugh.
Working with the what?
The posse.
Oh.
Posse. Yes, posse's a term.
I don't know where the origins come.
Possibly, yeah, it should be, yeah. But yeah. Obviously, this is the first time it's reached Swindon. It might be for your ears, but.
It's a bit of
a late
term for him, Chris. He's sort of saying groovy and things
groovy,
like that.
Yes, hippie groovy. So, yeah, no, so it's good to be with the posse.
Nice.
The lads, yeah.
And Hattie? How are you?
I'm alright, thanks.
Good. How did you first get involved with Red Dwarf then?
I started doing stand-up from being a secretary, randomly, spontaneously, and then I got on Friday Night Live, and then the Red Dwarf executives saw me on Friday Night Live and thought I was a good Norman equivalent for Parallel Universe, because I was very deadpan. So.
Right.
And so then they put me up in that one episode. And then there's about 18 months between series 2 and 3. And by which time Norman had left and they auditioned people. And I was asked to audition, which I hadn't really done that sort of thing, because I was still, I was still all new to it.
Yeah.
It was kind of the first thing I did. So you start at the top, really, and I went to the audition. They said, they gave me a bit of backwards to read and said, can you read this? So I read it and I laughed and they said, yeah, can you read it out loud? Because I'd read it to myself.
Right.
And then they looked at each other and said, I think we've found a dumb computer.
And the part was yours?
Yeah.
Okay. Right, is anybody that would like to ask a question first off? We have a few. The young lady at the front.
My favourite impression, yeah, well, before I did Red Dwarf, I was working on Spitting Image, as we just discovered, with Neil Kinnicott and a bit of the Ronnie Reagan there. But I suppose one of my favourite impressions was the first kind of impression I ever did of a sort of public figure type person.
And that was Kenneth Williams, yes. Unfortunately, you see, I've got the nostrils for it, reserved. And of course, his voice goes down like this, you see. And then it goes up like that, you see, and starts in it. And of course, Mr. Brittas used a little bit of the voice as well, you see, like that, you know, a little bit Kenneth Williams.
But, you know, I quite enjoyed doing Lovely, Lovely Babies, Neil Kinnicott. Well, where's my brain? What's my name again? Ronald Reagan, and of course, extraordinary, David Goldman, a sports commentator that probably about three people in the audience. The average age is much lower than used to. A few of those sports commentators were you know, the horse.
horse racing in the centre. Very good on the stand side now, still winner around on the inside, step on the gas on the far side, is over to Michael O'Hare.
And they're going on the inside now, still winner around now, step on the gas.
If I ever do a sort of after dinner speaking turn, my act is like a sort of a trip back to the 80s, 70s, 80s. So I enjoy doing voices. And of course, it's the cast of Red Wolf, you know, that's quite fun to do.
Yeah! Oh, six of my nipples are tingling.
Yes, Mr. Rimmer, you are a boo boo on the smear good, all that sort of stuff. And of course, Lister. Totally fed up with me, then. Kind of stuff. So we've had a bit of practice over the years, let's just say.
And is impression something you still keep up to date with? Do you do up to date impressions now?
Not really, no. I kind of think that there's new people on the block, you know. Who did I do? Recently, I'll sort of hear people like Tony Blair, for example. I say the words Tony Blair, I feel a sense of not really wanting to get involved, waste my life. Right. Who did I do? Who did I do recently? Yes, I was having a little go at the deck. You've got Deck who talks like that. It's quite light and quite sensible. And the other one talks like that. So one or two, you know, just they just come to mind, you know. But it is fun. It's a knack. So. I did the teaching in school as well, so you know.
I was just about to ask whether you wanted me to delve into the pool of trouble that is Trump.
Sort of, yeah.
Right.
It is tremendous. America first. China. He says China. Every way he says China. But he is a. And he's this amazing thing with his finger. Like this, yeah. Thing, you know? He's. Yeah, there's a lot of material there, which he writes mostly himself.
Yeah. So we did have another question just there. Trust me, I'm a Jedi. You would.
Well, I wonder how you would come back from Red Dwarf, because the original show was about Red
Dwarf. There hasn't ever been that question to come back.
I'm forever recommending that Hattie's brought back, so hopefully I'll keep recommending it, and you never know.
Chris, that was a tenner well spent.
Right, any more questions?
Any more questions? I'm sure there are plenty more, come on.
Oh, we've got one.
Gentlemen there.
Greg, what's your favourite theory of all of them? What's your favourite to
all the series? I'm not sure. I mean, there's high points in all of the series. I think series 4 was one of my favourites.
Sorry, just a random guy just said.
Yes, it's sort of a regular thing that kind of happens. good to see you.
We did all see that, didn't we?
Series 4 was when we really were flowing well, because we'd done Series 1, which was the Will Anyone Like This? We'd done Series 2, people are starting to like this. Series 3 was, hey, they love it, now we're going to take it to another level. And Series 4 was the first one of the Shepperton shows, the Shepperton series. And of course, for me, Ace was his first arrival in that series. So I pick out 4, but you know, they all have their own hallmarks that separate them, of course. Somewhere around the time we met the Gelfs, didn't we? There's Stephen there, who was a memorable scene, of course, in Red Dwarf that day, which we shot out the back of Shepperton. I think I got rather inebriated that night. It was such a cold night, we had to sort of walk around hip flasks, keeping our innards warm.
That's the excuse, is it? Because it was cold, right.
And, we all finish with the immortal line of this to go, so yes, I'd say around 4 or 5.
We had another question just come in.
Do you think there will be a number of series?
Well, of course, as you know, we've got Series 12 already made, which goes out in this autumn coming. And we are talking about doing another series. I hope it's another two, because we've decided we don't want to end on Series 13. Right? So it'll be another two, if I have my way, you know. And I think Danny, I know, is keen to do two more. I know Craig and Robert are keen, and Doug's keen, but there's a few administrative hurdles, I think, is the expression, to get over before we do that.
Has there ever been talk of doing a movie at
all? Yes, for about 10 years.
Right. But has it only ever been talk? Has there ever been a script? Has it ever gone just more than a storyline?
I think there were scripts written.
Right.
But I to be honest, I don't know anything about the nuts and bolts of all that happened, trying to get the funding sorted out. But Back to Earth was, if you like, a three-parter. So if you put that all together, you'd have one hour, 20 minutes Red Dwarf story, which in a sense was a kind of the movie, you know, the movie ambition sort of satisfied to a certain extent. But then we realized that actually what the public really wants, or the Red Dwarf fans really want, are, you know, half-hour episodes with an audience.
Right. Do you think it would work in the movie format, though? Or do you think, like you say, it's made specifically for people taking half-hour chunks?
I think it could work as a movie, you know, but it's associated so much with a live audience. And, you know, our performances are sort of tapered that way, that I think certainly with Back to Earth, it was quite tricky. People watched it, there was no audience, and it was, and people didn't really, you know, people are comfortable with what they know. And I think that was a little bit of a shock for them, sort of a shock, but, you know, it just wasn't really what they were expecting. So, but I think, yeah, if it was all billed as a movie and people were sort of expecting a movie, then I think it could work, yeah. Mm.
So what's been the big difference between going from like the BBC to Dave now? Has there been a difference in the filming or anything like that?
Well, in that period of time, 10 years difference, yeah, the whole TV industry, the whole world changed in that 10 years. So for with Dave now, what seems to be the difference is the studio seems to be smaller, the schedule seems to be shorter, and the budget seems to be tighter.
Right.
So, you know, all those things taken into consideration, you know, we're not as young as we used to be. So, which isn't a bad thing necessarily. We might not have the physical energy, but we kind of know how to pace ourselves. It just seems a little bit more budget aware and time aware, than it used to be in the days of the BBC, when it was just, we might need an extra day here, but that's no big deal. You know, it can be quite a, let's just call it a busy studio, with an hour to go.
Are the cameras smaller as well? I just find, because I used to sit there facing a great big camera, now, if people got something on their head.
Yeah,
you can see the gentleman there with his little camera there.
A helmet camera, I think. The BBC ones, you'll bear this out, were quite big, huge, great pedestal things that, you know, were big encasing things around the lenses and everything. But yeah, the modern ones are smaller, and are on little, they are on pedestals if you want, but also they can be handheld as well, so that's all different. We were using a particular form of technology that seemed to be quite, its stability seemed to be not overly reliable initially, which caused a few problems. But you know, problems we got over. Mm. Whereas in the days of the BBC with those big pencil cameras, you didn't think about that. They just recorded it, and that was it. You didn't worry about, you know. So pretty different.
Mm.
But then, you know, we hope the results are, you know.
Mm. So Hattie, when you filmed your scenes, did you just did